Okay, great, awesome. All right, so I feel like, well, let's just start. So yeah, 2016, we have this awesome new world where we have these really starting to be mature packages like Theano and TensorFlow and even Sten, where, you know, the dream is you just specify your model or your forward computation and both all the differentiation and optimization or inference is sort of there for you already. And, you know, this is a really big deal and it led to the democratization of machine learning. But, you know, anyone who's actually spent time trying to implement sort of non-trivial or non-like sort of example models in these frameworks has come across, I'm sure, like a few really big problems that have sort of already been solved a long time ago, in some sense. So, for instance, if you want to do something like having loops that have, you know, a adaptive stop condition or if statements, for instance, using recursion or even like closures in one of these mini languages, or rather these frameworks, you know, they're starting to add these, you know, cond or scan, these sort of, I would say, hard to use versions of the primitives that we already have in high level languages. You also sort of lose like transparent access to the debugger, and we have to, you know, interpret the sort of indecipherable error messages of some new second compiler or interpreter. And, you know, writing an interpreter is hard and a compiler is hard, but even harder is getting it to give you helpful error messages, and that's a huge software engineering challenge. Plus, we have a new language that we have to learn, right? So maybe we already learned Python or NumPy, and now we say, okay, now I want to do an if statement, I have to look it up as like the new TensorFlow if statement. So what I'm gonna propose to you is that we don't actually have to make these compromises. And specifically using this tool that was actually initially started to be developed by Dougal McLaurin, who can't be here, and then later picked up by and extended by me and Matt. So it's an automatic differentiation package that wraps Python and lets us differentiate almost any native Python code that you would write. So the idea here is that we're just going to use the full featured Python to express our models in like nice, modular, sort of higher order code. And of course, we need to do heavy-duty numerical operations, so we wrapped gradients around most of the useful parts of NumPy and SciPy. And we can handle all the nice things that we are come to, you know, depend on, like closures. The other nice thing that we can do now is use data structures throughout our specifying our model. So instead of having to, you know, flatten our gradients or something like that, we can use things like dicts or tuples of arrays, however nested you want. And we have easy access to derivatives, and the most beautiful thing about this whole thing is that we expose all this functionality through a single function, grad, which just gives you the gradient of the function that you wrote. Okay, and so, I mean, we can't really hold a candle to the user base of, say, TensorFlow, but it is downloaded fairly often and used extensively in the sort of adjacent to deep learning communities, such as, you know, people writing simulations for population networks. And due to the sort of nice terseness that we have here, like for instance, someone wanted to write a reference implementation of the neural Turing machine, and they wrote it in not too many lines of autograd. And I mean, if you understand how complicated a neural Turing machine is to write, this should give you an idea of sort of the capability of this tool. Okay, so one thing I want to say about autograd, just to give you an example. So, first of all, autograd is basically three things. It's a wrapper around NumPy. It's a list of gradients of all the operations in NumPy. And it's just a little bit of logic to implement the chain rule on top of that. So the bulk of this our small code base is just a lot of definitions of derivatives that look like this, where we define the gradient of different operations in terms of other NumPy operations. And this is, of course, how we can have access to higher order derivatives, is that we define the cross products in terms of another false cross product, and we can, of course, now compute the second derivative. There's also things that we can take gradients through that I'm not sure it's obvious that it's meaningful to take gradients through, such as sorting, where we actually can ask, you know, what is the, well, gradient through sorting, which actually just means permuting the gradients of all the individual elements. Just to give you an idea, this actually is sort of a mature package. Here is, just, you know, a few of the things we've implemented. And just I want to highlight a few. For instance, Einstein summation. It basically is a superset of almost half of NumPy. Anytime you are doing something, any linear operation that can be expressed, is called an Einstein. All the linear algebra, of course, like the eigenvectors and eigenvalues of the matrix. Okay, so now I'm going to show you what sort of machine learning code can look like when you have access to structs and, well, all the higher order nice language features that we're used to. So at the top here, we have just, instead of importing NumPy, we import autograph.numpy. That's sort of the only price we have to pay when we just make sure that all the code that we're differentiating through imports this at the top. And now, what is a multi-layer perceptron? Well, it's a for loop over layers in the network, where at each layer we have a linear transformation and a nonlinear transformation. And this for WB and weights actually is unpacking a list of tuples. Each, W is a matrix, B is a vector. And, the only thing left here to do is to create that list of vectors and tuples, which of course is just another for loop. Once we define a loss function at the bottom here, then to get the gradient of this whole thing, we just call grad of log prob pump, which implicitly takes the gradient with respect to the first argument. So I think that it's easy to lose track of like how simple the operations we're doing here. And actually, one of the things I want to say that autograd is good for is pedagogy, right? So teaching a first-year student about machine learning and then saying, oh, okay, you just have to compose these TensorFlow layers. It's like, well, it's not quite clear what's going on. But here it's sort of crystal clear that there's just this tiny bit of computation happening. So I said that, weights here is actually a list of tuples. So that raises the question, what does the gradient of a list of tuples look like? Well, let's ask. So here we're going to call the gradient of log prob at the initial parameter values and give it some training data. And now, of course, the gradient of a list of tuples and parameters is, again, a list of tuples of gradients. So this is really nice to let us inspect what's going on in different parts of our learning. So we can say, what's going on with respect to the, weights in the penultimate layer or something like that. And we wrote these nice little helper functions called flatten and unflatten, which, optimizers require flat gradients. So what we're going to do is just, here's Adam, the inner part is Adam, and then just the input and output has this nice flatten and unflatten logic. That means that I can preserve, I can use dicts, but as far as Adam is concerned, it's just these vectors. All right, and now just to show off, here is us implementing a Hessian vector product in AutoGrad. So the Hessian vector product is defined sort of mathematically here in the middle of the slide. It's just the Hessian times the vector. And it turns out that you can construct this by using a closure where we just say, we'll define the vector times the gradient as a function, and then ask for the gradient of the output of that function. And this defines the Hessian vector product. It costs only four times as much, about four times as much time to evaluate this as it does to just compute the function itself. We don't explicitly compute the Hessian here. But the point is that this code is clean, right? Like what's going on is conceptually simple, and what's going on in the code is just simple to write. As maybe an even more extreme example of this, we have this helper function called Jacobian, which just calls grad on every output and gives us the Jacobian. And if we want to define the Hessian of the function, well, we just take the Jacobian of the Jacobian, right? And this is actual code that we're running. This is not pseudo code. Okay, so to take this to a sort of more very realistic example, here is a fluid simulator. And written in just pure NumPy, and has for loops and some control flow. And there's no reason why we can't differentiate through this code just as it sits, right? And NumPy is a really nice first language, so there's a lot going on here in a small amount of code. So what I'm showing here on the right is an initial, like a random velocity field, that if I were to run it forward according to these dynamics, would sort of swirl around the fluid in this random way. And if we were to take gradients through this entire procedure of like maybe 50 steps of this fluid simulation, we could then actually optimize the fluid simulation such that at time 50, it's in a state that we can control. So here is an optimized initial fluid field, such that when I run it forward, it swirls all the ink into a picture, right? And this works for any picture. And to prove this, when I was doing my job talks, I always made a demo of producing the logo of whatever school I was interviewing at. So here's University of Toronto's tree after being initializing or optimizing the initial fluid field. Okay, so I hope we all agree that you can optimize through anything, but when you just already wrote the code, and it's like the code that was already sitting around, and you can optimize it, it sort of starts to like get you excited, like maybe I don't have to think about what new thing I can optimize through, I can actually just optimize through all the code I already had sitting around. Okay, Oh yeah, and we had more fun with this. You can optimize any objective, of course, through fluid simulation. So here, I optimized the lift to drag ratio with respect to this sort of green shape here, which is parameterized by like the opacity to fluid of all these little cells, and it sort of found this sort of wing shape. Okay, so after we wrote Autograd, there was a long period when we just sort of were going through and realizing we could optimize through all sorts of things. And we also, for a little while, didn't realize that, well, there's this one optimization procedure that we're performing all the time, which was optimizing the hyperparameters of our machine learning algorithms, right? So we were doing grad student descent, this horrible sort of human in the loop finite differences where you know, run your experiment, check the validation error, change the regularization a little bit, run it again. And, you know, right down the hall, there's this entire workshop on black box optimization. And the sort of flagship product of Bayes' after black box optimization is optimizing hyperparameters, because it's this expensive black box that we always want to optimize. You know, and this function takes in our regularization parameters, optimization parameters, validation data, and then computes the validation loss. Right? And people say, well, we don't have gradients, so we have to do this expensive optimization. Of course, this black box is not a black box. We wrote this box. We know what's inside this box. It is like 10,000 iterations of gradient descent, followed by evaluating our model on the validation set. And we wrote all this code in maybe NumPy. So there's no reason why we can't actually differentiate through the entire training procedure and validation check, and then get gradients with respect to our hyperparameters. Okay. You know, and once we start doing this, we realize that people say, oh yeah, my algorithm has 10 hyperparameters, and someone says, ah, mine has 9. And it's like, no, your algorithm has sort of uncountably many hyperparameters, and we're all just embarrassed to admit how many there are. And we pretend there's only 10 because we can only optimize 10. But once you can optimize, you know, we're not afraid of optimizing a million parameters in our models or a billion, and there's no reason why we can't optimize a million hyperparameters as well once we have gradient-based optimization. Because gradient-based optimization scales as dimension, as we all know. So, for instance, we typically tune a single learning rate in our experiments. And of course, this seems totally crazy. We know that the dynamics of the loss surface are changing, like, you know, have a high dynamic range from the beginning of optimization to the end. And there's sort of like some lore that's been like hard won through years of experiments where they say, oh, okay, start with, you know, learning rate 0.001, then after 10,000 iterations, change it to be, you know, 0.01, whatever. Now we have this like new microscope where we can just directly examine what are the optimal training curves. And here we have actually, for a four-layer neural network trained on MNIST, asked, you know, use gradient-based optimization of the hyperparameters to find what is the best training schedule per iteration and per layer. And it's that it says, aha, you know, we should train the first layer, or rather the layer closest to the image, or rather closest to the label, fastest first, then train the bottom layers fast, and then at the end everybody slows down, maybe kind of like a Nesterov sort of regression. Actually, I showed this to Yang Lekun and said, aha, this makes sense, because how can the lower layers know what they are supposed to mean if the top layer hasn't sort of decided what its units mean? Which made sense to me, but if he had said the opposite thing, I would have also agreed. So I think that there, you know, exists an opportunity to write some papers where we actually, you know, use this tool to say, well, what would the actual optimal thing be under different circumstances? Okay. And then, again, the limiting factor in some of our research after we made Autograd was just like realizing that there was stuff that we optimized that we wouldn't otherwise consider. And so the sort of crazy extreme of this was this experiment where we optimized the training data. And what I mean by that is we were training through a neural network on MNIST, and we fixed a validation set of 10,000 real examples that we're not going to change. And now we say, let's pretend the training set is only 10 examples with labels 0 through 9. And now we can treat every pixel of every training example as a hyperparameter and ask what are the optimal sort of canonical images that would give us the best validation set error. And this is the same problem that NASA had to solve when they made the plate for the Voyager probe, where they drew, you know, the like canonical man and woman saying hi. It's like, what, you know, image could I show an alien so that the alien's neural network would then generalize well to all humans? I mean, obviously this is like a crazy idea that we probably wouldn't want to do in reality. There is a more sane version of this where people have data pre-processing steps as part of their pipeline. For instance, they might add noise to their data set. That procedure has hyperparameters that we can also optimize through gradient descent. Okay. So one of the other main pain points, maybe more prosaic things that people run into when they're trying to use things like TensorFlow or Theano, is that they have some Google recurrent neural network that, you know, has like depth that depends on the data, or you know, a number of nodes is determined at runtime, and then they start to implement this with like scanf or cond or whatever, it doesn't work. And we actually had the exact same problem when we were working on regression on molecules, where we have to take an arbitrarily sized input as a graph as input and somehow convert this into a fixed size vector. So I won't go into detail, but what we chose to do was have the sort of convolutional networks on the graphs where we did message passing within the graph and then turn that into a fingerprint. And the point is that every training instance has a different computational graph. And after we implement this in TensorFlow and AutoGrad in a completely straightforward way, afterwards some people re-implemented it in Theano by having, it was sort of like a hero effort where they had to have these like big sort of matrices padded with zeros and a lot of sort of wasted computation. The point is, like, writing down the actual code for this is straightforward if you can actually use, you know, if statements and for loops and stuff like that. Okay, you might say, well, sure, that sort of takes care of like Theano and TensorFlow. But what about things like Stan? I mean, maybe I'm a statistician who wants to make a model, and then Stan does not only provide automatic computation, it also provides a little language for me to specify my model in which there are existing inference algorithms. To which I would say, well, yes, so Stan has an amazing auto-diff engine and a nice mini, like a nice language for specifying models, and it does have these inference schemes, but these inference schemes are a tiny amount of code that is, again, just like a little bit of numerics. And so, to drive this point home, actually, Ryan tweeted me Blackbox to ADVI, like automatic differentiation variational inference. He put it in a tweet. This is actual Python code that will run. It just defines the variational evidence lower bound, like a stochastic approximation of it. And then we can just take the gradient through that with respect to our variational parameters, right? So to me, like the standard vision is, I'd say, appropriate for maybe like someone without a software engineering background who just wants a lot of examples and someone else to take care of the inference. But as someone in machine learning, I want to tweak the inference and my model together. And now if I have a higher order language, or rather a sort of actual full-featured programming language, I can write my model in one little like file, tiny amount of code, my inference algorithm in another little bit of code, and then you know the glue that makes it all work is automatic differentiation. Oh yeah, okay. And so just to give a demo of this and see if this works. So that code that is in that tweet, now I'm going to call it. So what it does is it takes in a likelihood function. So here I've implemented a neural network. It's the same for loop as before, but I had to do a little bit of extra work to vectorize across parameter values. So the idea is we're going to try not only mini batches over data, but mini batches over different parameter values. Right. And so we've replaced the linear transformation of like a weight matrix multiply with this Einstein thing. But again, this is just a standard NLP. We can define, you know, the size of the neural network, what the nonlinearity is, and you know, this defines a normalized log posterior over which we can do inference. So we're just going to pass our unnormalized log posterior to this BBSVI, which is those five lines that I showed you before, and then pass that thing will give us a new objective and its gradient, and we will just pass that to, you know, some atom optimizer. All right, so let's see if this works. All right, so here we are. So here, what you're seeing is samples from the variational posterior as they're being fit to data. It's kind of hard to see the data. It's like, you have these blue points here and here. And okay, now it's settling down a little bit. And of course, it's doing the right thing that inference would tell us to, which is that, you know, we should be certain where the data is and uncertain where the data isn't. And the reason that these things are changing slowly is that, yeah, I'm using a fixed random seed to draw from the approximate variational posterior, and so as that posterior changes, the points change only smoothly. Okay, so you know this is a very small amount of code, and then the beauty is that if I were, say, Yann LeCun in like, I think it was like 2010, I'd say, oh, guys, what if instead of using like an RBF, we said, oh, well, you know, just to find this little closure here, 0x. All right, so now we have a relay loop, right? And let's see what that looks like. Boom. Anyway, I'm not saying we like this model more, but the point was, it was just, you know, really trivial to change this. And of course, now also, I can say, aha, I don't like this Gaussian approximation to my posterior, I want to make it a mixture of Gaussians. Well, now I can just go back to my inference code and update it to be a mixture of Gaussians. Which I already have. I'm not going to show that today. Incidentally, I love this posterior. It really says anything to be happening with the data. Okay. All right. Okay. So I want to say, yes, we are in this awesome new world. Yes, Gano and TouchExplorer are great, specifically because of their really good GPU support, which I must admit PongoDev does not have yet. But having access to higher order, sort of the mature language features that we all know and love, like debuggers and nice error messages, makes a lot of things easy, namely data-dependent graphs, which, you know, there's also the like program induction workshop next door, where there, everything is always like a data-dependent computation graph. Higher order operations like, you know, optimizing through an optimizer is no problem because our optimizer is already written in NumPy. And also really small sort of like lispy code just like falls out naturally when we have, you know, actually the power of these like nice mature languages that we've been developing over like 80 years. Okay, and then the last point I want to make is that not only just good for pedagogy, I was surprised by how much more stuff we thought of doing just when we lost the mental overhead of having to fight, you know, our automatic interpretation engine and just sort of assume that it's sort of fine. So, yeah, three times. All right. Oh, and I have to say, yes, Google should be here. He is the guy who just sat in the chair and then, like, wrote these 80 lines. You guys should check out the first commit of AutoGuide. It's like a tiny, tiny amount of code. Matthew Johnson will be talking a little bit more about how AutoGuide actually works after lunch. And, of course, Ryan, who scored a desk in this. All right. Thank you very much. Yeah, so yeah, the question was, well, you talk about differentiating through, you know, things like an entire training procedure, but doesn't that introduce this like horrible memory requirement or time memory trade-off? And the answer is yes. And so the paper was actually about how to address the memory requirements. So the first thing I'll say is that it's really easy to define new gradients in AutoGrad. You can just say, this function has this gradient, and everything is written in Python. There's no, you don't have to like contact the developers or anything like that. So it was easy for us to say, okay, this one step is going to be, we're going to handle the logic for that, and with this like fancy tape and stuff like that, and that's fine. And the other thing I'm going to say is that, you know, extensions to that work will look like, okay, we'll actually train a neural network to predict what the reverse path would look like. This is like a much more general solution. And then, again, we want to add really fancy stuff inside of the like gradient calculation, and that's all going to be easy, and again, also differentiable through, again, at the end of the day.
Yep. You made a claim that we can now differentiate higher level programming languages. That was in one of your final slides. That's a shift from just Python to higher level programming languages. So are there thoughts about expanding this work or?
Yeah. Well, I mean, so I missed. Oh yeah. So the question is, I was talking about sort of differentiating through higher order languages, and I guess I was sort of making an imprecise statement, but. Basically, I'm saying we can blend all the like fancy functional stuff that we can do in like Haskell or whatever with automatic interpretation. I mean, this is exactly what Graph Perlmutter has been doing, you know, consistently and, you know, blowing everyone's minds with stuff that you can do. So I guess I will defer to him on that. I just say that there's a lot of sort of cross-pollinization that happens when you're doing AutoDiff and sort of higher order functional programming. Yeah, so this guy, Jamie Townsend, has been adding forward mode to AutoGrad. And I mean, I guess there I would say that because it's just so little code, I mean, it's not a big deal. I mean, the only real work is adding the forward mode gradients to everything. But that's sort of fun, actually. I mean, the nice thing about writing this software is that it's so easy to write tests for because you can just use a numerical gradient for everything that you can change things with impunity, and you also know when you really solved it. And also, the experiments are always tiny. It's like a funny thing that maybe Matt's going to talk a bit more about, that most operations sort of are their own gradients if you just call them with different parameters or something like that. Or you end up with these tiny little groups of, like, you know, sine is the gradient of cos, which is the gradient of negative sine, and stuff like that. So I would say it's very easy and fun. Actually, and because we only have a single function API, actually just last night, we pushed the change to AutoGrad that completely rewrote the internals. Does not use tape to use the topological sort internally, and all the tests passed. It was no big deal.